My pleasure.
It's good to talk about this path after realizing the truth. Because a lot of times I had a hard time dealing with things that came up after I went past the gate. Mm-hmm. In liberation release context, they say that we crashed the gate. And one of the aspects of that path was that a lot of emotions came up, which I didn't, I couldn't see before gating, before realizing in the LU context. And so it was like a lid came open and a lot of things came up with that opening. And so I had to come up with ways to cope with these strong emotions, like anxiety, bitter stress. And for me, it was like I knew that there was no separation, but I still acted like I was separate. But there was this remainders of this habit of thinking or acting in a separative way. And so I used to watch these emotions as something outside me. I knew that it's not outside me, but I still acted in that way. So one of the ways that I tried is to apply what I realized from the LU process, which didn't really work, because it was like, it was more like by doing so, I was forcing myself to fit into one framework of realization. Mm-hmm. But that was not the thing for me. So I continued sitting, doing Zazen, which helped me a lot, because Zazen is not something you, there's nothing conceptual that can be, can come into it. It's hard to explain in words, but it's like just being or just sitting. it literally just sitting without doing anything. But people, or including myself, tend to do something if you're told to just sit. You try to do something with the thoughts that come up because it's uncomfortable. When you are forced to face the thoughts that are uncomfortable, you try to get rid of it, first of all, or you try to change it. Yeah. Or you try to do some special techniques and breathing or things like that to mold it into one way you want it to be, but that won't work. Because once you may feel like it's gone, but it will come back later. Mm-hmm. So the most effective way to cope with it is to just let it be there. It sounds a bit easy to say that, but it's true that you let it be there and you let it come and let it go nowhere. It comes from nowhere and it goes nowhere. I wouldn't say it comes or goes. It's just there when it is, and it's not there when it's not. That's it. So that was that is what is beautiful about Dazen, is that it's you literally don't do anything while you do it. Mm. And that's beautiful. Mm. So that really helped me. And can I go on talking about?
Yeah, sure. course.
And there's one thing about koan,
mm-hmm.
Which I'm working on as a project, which is not really a classic way of koans. Well, probably a lot of people don't know about what koans are, so I will, it might be helpful to explain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Koans are the records of the dialogues or the sayings of Zen monks or those who practice Zen or those who mastered Zen from the ancient Chinese period. I'm not really sure how to call that in English. So it's an ancient Chinese record, the dialogues and sayings. And it was live at that time. So it was a live dialogue, live interaction between people engaged in Zen. But later, in the later period, people started using it as themes or as materials for your practice to just recreate that setting or that understanding, which was done in the ancient period. So the setting is that the teacher would use or give not a story, but one material to the student, and the student will work on it, but not intellectually. It's more with his or her whole being, and he or she tries to be that material, not think about, not try something, but they I wouldn't say become one, but yeah, they try to become one, and they will be that. And at the right moment, they be that, they will know the answer because they are, you know, they are the koan itself. So it works that way, koan. And so it has been passed on to this modern period as a tradition. Mm. And as I told you, I was given one of these koans, well, one of the most fundamental koans, which is the koan of mu, with which you try to become one with mu, and you not try to, well, as long as you're trying to become one, you're not one. So that's one thing, but you be one, you be mu. So you do something like move all the time. And by doing that, you realize that there's no separation between you and move. Mm. And literally you move, and everything is move also. So that's a very simplified explanation of what I did with koan. And now I'm trying to recreate that in a more context-free setting. So it doesn't have to be Zen at all. It doesn't have to be Buddhism at all. It doesn't have to be Christianity at all. So it's more of a non-restricted way. But I would like to keep the essence of what these monks in the ancient China were doing. So the basic idea is to help people realize their true nature and realize that there's no separation at all. Mm. So yeah, that's one of the big projects of my life now. Mm. Yeah.
Very interesting. Mu means? Mu is not, what is the meaning of mu?
Mu. Mu means in English nothing.
Nothing.
Mm. Mm-hmm. In contrast to u, which is something. Yeah. So that has been one of the most classic koans used by Rinzai, especially by used by Rinzai sect to have the practitioner have the first realization into their own nature. And there's this whole set of koans afterwards, so that he cope with this after seeing period, which is quite hard to cope with without guidance. Yeah, so it covers the whole range of the beginning through the end, so to speak, the end, where he isn't concerned about anything like Zen or Buddhism or whatever anymore. He's perfectly ordinary without any concern about Zen, something special. They tell that that's the end, the goal. So yeah, that was also helpful for me, having conversation with the teacher using these koans as materials, because it's made to assist you in your process through this pausing period. You know, someone would say it's a period of embodiment. I heard this word used in not in the context of non-duality also. Some people use that. So yeah, and it took me a while, like four or five years to get used to this mode of living life. And now, you know, when you say it's settled, there is something there, you know, it's a bit unsettled, because as long as you're saying that you're settled, there's this slight you that is looking at yourself and, you know, these all kind of things. But yeah, I would say that I'm grateful that there's nothing much to search anymore, and I'm happy with
such a relief is this when the searching and seeking drops. An immense relief.
That feels really freeing.
True.
Yeah, light, that you are really, you know that you don't have to search anything anymore. You can just be there and relax. It's like you're in hot spring, and you know you're enjoying that warmth.
I would like to share about my experience with koans, but with this Zen, I don't know, sayings or stories, you could say, these simple stories between, let's say, conversation between the master and the student and so forth. So there was something that touches me deeply, but I didn't know what it is before came across the Liberation Unleashed forum. So I read these stories and came across Facebook or friend or never mind. And there was something, but I just, my mind just got blank, you know, just like, what is this? It shocked me. So, something like this, but I didn't know what it is. Not that I know now, but after the Liberation Unleashed process, it is so obvious. It's like, you know, and there is a sense that I could write this also. It's just like, I know what it is, but it's hard to express it by words, you know, but you know, they are all pointing the one thing.
Right. It's talking about the same thing. And you know.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, I think we share the same experience about that. Mm. And the amazing thing about Zen is that they have, you know, when we talk about this realization, how we talk about that realization depends on that person, the personality. Yeah. So every guide or every person who has gone through this process has original way of talking about this.
Yeah. Flavor. And something
yes,
like flavor.
Flavor, yes. Yeah. And in that, those records of Zen, there are a whole bunch of these Zen people for talking about this one thing in a myriad way of telling things. And it's amazing, you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, it's also interesting to get in touch with these wisdom and see how it's expressed, you know? Sometimes it's expressed in a very mysterious way, and it's expressed in a very, very, very simple way.
Direct. And also, some people call this message, I've heard this, maybe you also, that this message is arrogant, you know, like it's too direct. So when there is probably a sense of a self, and it sounds to a self arrogance, you know, arrogant.
I see. Yeah, it's threatening.
Yeah.
To your sense of self, because it was done to break through that. Yes. So one thing would be that you won't hear it, you won't listen to it, or you will deny it.
Yeah.
Or you will say that it's meaningless, or
it's crazy, or
or it sounds too ordinary that you won't notice that that's talking about something, you know, that has a value in it. There's one of my favorite stories or recollections in which a master tells, there's a student who is new to that mountain. He comes, and he goes to the master that lives in the mountain, and he asks the master what to do, what should I practice, and so on. And then the master asks, have you finished your breakfast? Have you finished eating your breakfast? And the student answers yes. And then the master tells, go wash your bowl. It's funny, huh?
Yeah.
I love this. I love this simplicity.
Yeah.
Or someone may say that, come have some tea.
Yeah. Beautiful. Oh, so good.
Perfect. It's perfectly said in that one phrase. There's nothing more to say other than that.
Yeah.
Yeah, great. Yeah.
Lovely.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Anything you want to ask more?
Maybe. I don't know.
Yeah. It's nice that as I talk, I always, when I talk about this, I find something that wasn't found, that hadn't been found, that I could share, so I could add, you know, as some kind of information for others, as something that they could find helpful. And that's something that I'd be happy with if I could share.
I don't know, just it's nice to sit like this and share.
Yeah. Even the silence, you know, feels comfortable as a there's something reverberating after this talk, you know.
Yeah.
And you feel something.
Yeah, the silence is almost like there is so much in the silence. So much. It's I don't know the word in English, but it's, I'm trying. Never mind.
You know, there are a lot of micro, how can you say that, microorganisms or
it's like full of, you
know, inside your body, so they don't make any noise, but they're still working, you know. And when you see this whole, you know, something that is here, that something is happening here, you know, when you look out a window, there's a whole bunch of these things, micro or whatever we can call it. But there's this whole activity going on. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Right? And it's there's a limit to this. When you use words, there's a limit in describing.
Yeah. It's almost impossible to describe. Yeah. What you are experiencing. It's experience is so much more rich. And
it's also beautiful if that comes as a form of art or as a form of poetry, as a form of dialogue. And the beauty of trying to convey this through something that is tangible.
Yeah.